I'd like to welcome everyone to our morning devotion, and I believe we've been learning a lot from it. I myself has been inspired by the passages every Sunday morning na pinag-aaralan po natin in this place. Ano po? And this morning, it's just a continuation of the passage during the night when our Lord Jesus has been betrayed. There is a lot of things that happens, and one of the disciples has been his character has been pretty mentioned a lot during the night that the Lord has been tried. So it's just a continuation, the life of Peter. The passage that we are going to focus on this morning, we will find him again failing. He failed before once, denying the Lord once, and then he's going to complete the three times today. This morning. So Daniel will going to help us with our devotion this morning.
And shall we all stand up as we read the Word of God? And it says here, "Now Simon Peter was standing and warming himself. So they said to him, 'You are also are not one of his disciples, are you?' He denied it and said, 'I am not.' One of the servants of the high priest, a relative of the man whose ear Peter had cut off, asked, 'Did I not see you in the garden with him?' Peter again denied it, and at once a rooster crowed." And shall we all pray? O Lord, our Heavenly Father, thank you for today, for giving us a brand new day, and for giving us to carry on living, O Lord God. And we're thankful for that, O Lord God, for your gift and for your mercy and of your grace, O Lord God. And Lord, as we ponder upon your word, may you help us get the things that we need, O Lord God. And may you please guide us as we go through it. And may nothing hinder us, O Lord God. And Lord, before anything, we would like to ask for forgiveness for the sins we have committed, O Lord God. We're sorry for the things we have done that are detestable and unsightly to you, O Lord God. We're sorry for that. And Lord, may you please bless us. And thank you once again for everything you have done in our lives. This we ask in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And you may all sit down. So, as Pastor mentioned right now, he was talking about that the person we're going to be looking at today is Peter. And I guess there's going to be three key points that we're going to be looking at on this passage, but the sources that we're going to get it from aren't always going to be on the book of John, because the other parts of the four synoptic gospels will make it more, will make it clearer to us as we look at it. So shall we all, to get everything put together, let's all open up our Bibles on Matthew chapter 26, and we'll be reading from verse 71 to 75. And it says here, "And when he went out to the entrance, another servant girl saw him, and she said to the bystanders, 'This man was with Jesus of Nazareth.' And again he denied it with an oath, 'I do not know the man.' After a while, the bystanders came up and said to Peter, 'Certainly you two are one of them, for your accent betrays you.' Then he began to invoke a curse on himself and to swear, 'I do not know the man.' And immediately the rooster crowed. And Peter remembered the saying of Jesus, 'Before the rooster crows, you will deny me three times.' And he went out and wept bitterly." And the second one that we're going to be looking at will be found on Luke chapter 22, verse 58 to 62. And it says here, "A little later, someone else saw him and said, 'You are also one of them.' But Peter said, 'Man, I am not.' And after an interval, about an hour, still another insisted, saying, 'Certainly this man was also with him, for he too is Galilean.'" So remember the one that we looked at before, they were talking about his accent, and now They're saying that he's Galilean. But Peter said, "Man, I do not know what you are talking about." And immediately while he was still speaking, the rooster crowed. And carrying on. And the Lord turned and looked at Peter. And Peter remembered the saying of the Lord of how he had said to him, "Before the rooster crows today, you will deny me three times." And he went out and wept bitterly. So the first thing that we're going to be looking at in this passage that we're currently looking at is how what we normally say don't tend to actually mean what we actually do. And but that is not the whole picture of it. This is also looking at it in terms of being saying what proclaiming something. Let's say you're proclaiming something that I'll reach this goal, but you cannot judge that you have met the goal until you actually truly hit the goal and probably not fall off during your way to the goal. So before this event, we know Peter proclaimed and he told Jesus about how he will be with Jesus till the end. And we will see that on Mark chapter 14. And shall we all open up our Bibles on Mark chapter 14? So these, the reason why we're looking at these other texts is the importance of seeing what else we're kind of missing at the same point at the current time. So we know that Peter said here on Mark chapter 14, verse 27, up to verse 31, and this is what happened. And Jesus said to them, "You will all fall away, for it is written, 'I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be scattered.' But after I am raised up, I will go before you to Galilee." And Peter said to him, "Even though they all fall away, I will not." And Jesus said to him, "Truly I tell you, this very night, before the rooster crows twice, you will deny me three times." But he said, empathetically, "If I must die with you, I will not deny you." And they all said the same. So once again, we can see how clear Peter was with his what he proclaimed. And once again, there's a time when we would say Peter did not meet this on the current happenings of what we are looking at when Peter denied Jesus three times. But if you look at Peter's life, you can see that up until the end, he did do what he said. So basically, this is the whole point that we're going to be looking at. Whatever is proclaimed by mouth, it can only be determined that it is done until everything is over. And so this is just an example. To say that you love someone and given all the opportunities to show it and did not do it until the end of time, or until the end of your life, you cannot say that you really have loved them. Now, until, you know, the time runs out. So, in a sense, mouth professions can only be described as momentarily and circumstantial, and you can only tell that you have done what you have said if it's until the end. So, this is why finishing the race is as important as starting it to many of us. So, as we know, last year there have been many not key people, but very well-known people that have fallen away from faith, and many of them have turned and denounced their faith. And I wouldn't say it's normal, but we will experience that in our lives. So, once again, the problem is. Actually, it isn't that they have lost faith or this and that. It is because they never had faith in the beginning. So one thing that we're going to be looking at even more as we look at the second point and third point is that the kind of battles that we face in life, normally we tend to fight it on our own. And this is where we're going to emphasize it, that the importance of fighting battles and actually faith with God and not faith on our own. So let's go back again on the passage that we're going to be looking at. And this is where everything begins. So it says here on verse 25, "Now Simon Peter was standing and warming himself. So they said to him, 'You are also not one of his disciples, are you?' He denied it and said, 'I am not.'" Now, currently, there are many things that we're going to be thinking. Why did Peter deny Jesus at this point? There are many reasons why. So number one is the fact that Jesus prophesied that he would deny him three times. So it must come to pass. So that's number one. And before everything happened here, we can already, the second one that we're going to be looking at is how Peter wasn't ready. As we can see, let's read on Mark chapter 14, verse 37. And we're going to be reading from verse 37 to 41. It says here, "So this is when Jesus took them and to pray. And he came and found them sleeping. And he said to Peter, Peter, Simon, are you asleep? Could you not watch 1 hour? Watch and pray that you may not enter into temptation. The spirit is indeed willing, but the flesh is weak.' And again he went away and prayed, saying the same words. And again he came out and found them sleeping, for their eyes were very heavy, and they did not know what to answer him. And he came the third time and said, 'Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? Is it not enough that the hour has come, that the Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners?'" So we can see that there is something going on behind the scenes. Peter here is not ready. And another one that we're going to be looking at is on Luke chapter 22, verse 31-32. So the first one is how unready Peter was. What we would say the main reason why is said here. So verse 31-32, and it says on chapter 22, "Simon, Simon, behold, Satan demanded to have you, that he might sift you like wheat. But I have prayed to you that your faith may not fail. And when you have turned again, strengthen your brothers." So as we can see here, Jesus revealed to Peter that Satan asked permission to sift Peter. But remember, there is a key importance here for us that we can take away from this. So as we looked up on Mark, we can see that Jesus told them to pray. And as we can also see on Luke, is how Jesus said, "I have prayed." So there is a key importance here of what we must do in times like these. So we know that a part of our life, we always pray. But there are also times in our lives where, I guess, prayer is not part of our habit. If we were to wake up in the morning, or if we were to go somewhere, do we actually pray and God, guide me through this day? And I'm not saying this to become something, it's like a chore, but it is something that comes from the heart. The heart that wants to pray to God, wants to communicate with God. Now, this is one of the not key happenings, or one of the part of our lives is that we tend to lose prayer in our lives. But it is also the sense of wanting to commune with God. And we know Peter has always been with Jesus, but in this key moment, we can see that he wasn't able to be equipped. And as we carry on, the first one we looked at is about finishing the race, and the second one is about what we should do in times like these. So I'll just carry on. Clearly, when we are losing battles, maybe we rely on ourselves too much, that we don't fight it with God. This is one takeaway that we can have from this passage, is that the life we live it with God. Like we live, sorry, not because sometimes the way I say it is different. So we live it with God, not on our own. And we can see that Peter has been very vocal about what he intends to do. But this, when he's very vocal about it, it is very reliant on yourself and not of God. And we can clearly see that in life, the more you are, I guess, you're very sensitive about it, and the more you're spiritually growing, you tend to see that without God, and when you rely on your own ability, you can see that everything that you do is not as, actually, it's not even as good as you think it was. It's actually not where God wants you to be, nor it is something to be praiseful about. And as we carry on, we know that when we talk about the armor of God, we know that one of them is, or the final one is, the prayer. And this should be the one equipping us. So one passage that we're going to be looking at, it says here on James chapter 4, verse 2. And it says here, you desire and you do not have, so you murder, you covet, and you cannot obtain, so you fight and quarrel. So this is the main one that we're going to get. You do not have because you do not ask. Now, if we knew, but if we look at it this way, we already knew that Jesus has prophesied that Peter would deny him three times. So once again, it is inevitable that this must come. But once again, if we were in a situation in our lives where, because we do not know what's going to happen in our future, but Peter know, it was revealed to Peter what was going to happen in the future. How? Why is it not possible for us to pray in times like these? When, and I'm going to be explaining a bit more on what kind of situations is going to be like for us in the future as well later on. But one thing that we do need, especially every day in our life, is the power of prayer and the one who's always reliant on God. And as we carry on, because as we carry on, we're going to be putting everything together later on. So as we carry on, there will come a point in our lives where we will have to make this stand. So we know that we will go through persecutions in our lives, and we will go through trials and hardships. So we're going to be taking this passage to a literal extent, as it is. So in terms of, like, let's say, not in a workplace, but outside in public or in front of people, there are times where we're going to be ridiculed for our faith. And in a sense, this will give us fear, and I guess some of us will say peer pressure, and we will go through this. And to put it to a more extreme extent, in the future, and I pray that none of us are going to be there, in the tribulations, this is what's going to happen. When it comes in the end times, you will have a choice as well. Either do you worship the Antichrist, or you will be killed. So that's the extreme extent of how we could take this passage as well. So many of us, we will say in our hearts right now that I will not. And the more you think about it, and you think about it empathetically, like being there as of the moment, you know, there are people we have been asked to love, everyone as well, love in a sacrificial way. So that, to an extent, we're going to be caring about these other people's lives as well, like our family. And we don't know what's going to happen in the future. This is the reason why, when it comes to the thought of something we do not know about, but we tend to speak out about it as if we are able to do something about it, those are the times when it's actually self-reliant. And those are the times when we rely on ourselves even more. Now, for me, as I do not know what's going to happen in the future, if we were in those situations where we are being, I wouldn't say put to the test, but when there are times that we're going to be put in a situation where you had to choose about those things, those are the times, like what we talked about before, is to pray about it, and that you want God to be the one in control instead of yourself. Because as we know, when it becomes ourselves, it's very, it's going to be more about what you truly desire. But once again, we do know that when you're more in your life with God, we know that your desires change over time. And that's when you know it's the work of God. But once again, the one that we are trying not to feed here is our worldly desires that will affect how we, I guess, make decisions or we think. And one of the key points that we can see here as well, though it's been quite a very strong topic on like being away from yourself, is how gracious God is as well. It is how what the rooster's crows represent. So the rooster's crows represent three things. The first one is the extended hope to sinners. As we know, even though the crow ended and the time that Peter was tested here, as we know, everything has ended. After that, it wasn't the end for Peter. He became one of the most influential on the early churches, leaders, and he was also one of the most helpful people on Acts. And another one is supposed to be, it's supposed to be a wake-up call for us. It's the time when, from this moment on, the next time we see Peter is the moment Jesus is raised from the dead, and Jesus was telling him about, Peter, do you love me? And Jesus said that three times, and Peter said, Lord, you know how much I love you. But Jesus was also trying to tell Peter what kind of death he was going to have. So we can see that there is also a sense that from this moment that the rooster crowed on its last moment, that was a wake-up call for Peter, and that was a time where he changed. And as we know in the Beatitudes, when God talks about the blessed are those who are poor in spirit, for they will have the kingdom of God. We know that there are times in our lives where the biggest wake-up calls, and not only wake-up calls. So basically, when it comes to the word repentance, it is a change of mind, as we all know. And this change of mind will also change the way that you approach things. You wouldn't even try to dip your something into sin, I guess your toe or body parts. And so you wouldn't try to delve in it again, because it is a change of mind and it's a change of route. So as we know that being spiritually low in life, these are the times that where we actually truly find meaning in what God did. And these are the times where we're actually really sorry about the things that we're doing, and it changes our path. So another one, as the other meaning of the rooster crow, is a new day. We know that the rooster crowed before, and it was right around after midnight or midnight. And it represented a new day, and it also should represent for us a new day. So what does it mean to have a new day? So what it actually means is we know that God's mercies are new every day. And God, so these are the things we can apply. And this is the more heavier one. So when there are times in our lives where we sin, and we know that we're sorry about them in that time, but there are also some wrongdoings that we've done. So for example, we are in strife with one another, and we don't fix that for a while. So those are the times when we would say those are overdue sins that hasn't been asked for, asked forgiven for from God. The moment, I mean, for as long as you're still living, the point I'm trying to get across here is the moment that you're the reason why you're continuing living, actually not the reason. As you are still living, and you're still not dead, so that's still pretty heavy. You're still living. Those are your chances every day. Those are actually not even every day, every second. Those are the chances that God's giving you to ask for forgiveness from one another. And not only ask for forgiveness from one another, it is trying to please the God in your in heaven that he tells you to forgive one another. And not only forgive one another, he's also telling you to, as much as possible, think of like things that are honorable and things from heaven. And as we know, we would do things that are going, we are going to do things that are pleasing God. So that's another key component to this. So as we look up on Peter's life here, to round it all up in as much of a like impactful and meaningful way. So we know Peter here has made the mistake. And we can see that beforehand, Peter here wasn't prepared. And beforehand, we also know that Satan took asked permission to do something here. And as we know beforehand, this was also prophesied. But taking away the fact that what was going to happen is inevitable, because we know if you actually looked at things in the perspective of eternity, if you look at it in the perspective of eternity, you would see everything. You would see everything, you know, from back and forward. But for us, we're humans, we do not know that. This is why we live our lives as it is today. And we don't live as if, in the future, I'm going to be doing this, and I'll try to say sorry in the future. We should never look at it that way. We should look at it as if, at any moment, I would be gone at any time. And those are the times where we try to reconcile with one another and live our life out to what pleases God the most. So the moment you are living your life out not to please God, minute, hours, those times are actually being eaten away. Those are times, you would say time travel can be real, and then you go back in time, it's still going forward. So once again, they're getting taken away. And the moment you die, those are the times where you can't take it back anymore. Those are the times where, if Peter were to die as of that moment, you have to think as if it was you who was in this moment. You would live a life full of regret the moment you meet God in heaven. And carrying on, when it came to Peter's denial, once again, when there are times that you feel like you have wronged God in many ways, remember that Peter here denied God in front of man, yet God still used him, and Peter was still given a chance. So for many of us who are feeling hopeless in our sin or in our wrongdoings, remember God is always giving us a chance. Go back to God and always pray about it. And lastly, the power of prayer. It's such an important part of our lives, prayer. Do not neglect prayer, and do not neglect how God is powerful. We know that God can answer prayer, but when God doesn't answer prayer, it's still the best answer than what you yourself intended it to be. So whatever God's plan is in our lives, always be thankful that that's what happened, for it is the best answer you can have. And shall we all stand up and pray? Oh Lord, our Heavenly Father, we thank you, O Lord God, for the passage we have looked at, O Lord God. And we thank you for the life of Peter, O Lord God, and how we're able to see how great you are, O Lord God, how gracious you are, and how you have been merciful towards him, O Lord God. And we pray and thank you, O Lord God, that we know in many times of our lives, O Lord God, we truly don't deserve it, O Lord God, but yet you still gave it to us, O Lord God. And we're truly thankful for the life you have given to us, O Lord God, these chances that we are able to ask forgiveness from you, O Lord God, and to live our lives for you, O Lord God, and to love one another as brothers and sisters, O Lord God. So we thank you for these opportunities you've given to us, O Lord God. This we ask in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Okay, you may be seated again. Thank you, Daniel, for that inspiring devotion. And that's the life of Peter being transformed by the grace and by the power of God. And one thing that I've learned about the power, life of Peter that struck me the most is that personal courage alone is not enough to serve the Lord. So personal courage, if we are going to just rely on it, eventually and in the end, we will just deny the Lord. That's what happened to Peter. He relied on himself. He believes that he is completely and absolutely dedicated to the Lord. And that is true, actually. He was completely dedicated to the Lord on his own will. But in the end, he just denied the Lord. Not once, not twice, but three times. So we need the power of God and the working of the Holy Spirit in our lives. So we need to be reminded of that as we serve the Lord. So yung mainit ka sa Panginoon, sabi mo, Lord, all the way ako, I'll give everything to you. But you still lack something from the Lord. That won't be enough. That is one thing that always remind myself, mga kapatid. So can we all stand up as we come to close? Father God, we thank you, Lord, for the moment that you have been with us. Thank you for the reminding of your word. Thank you because every now and then that we ponder and listen up to your word, we are being fed, we are being inspired, and we are being comforted. Thank you for this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning, everyone who's here and those who are watching through YouTube or any social media. I would like to invite everyone to please rise and open your Bibles in Psalm, the book of Psalm, chapter 9. And I would like to invite everyone to read this with me. Psalm chapter 9. I will praise you, O Lord, with my whole heart. I will tell of all your marvelous works. I will be glad and rejoice in you. I will sing praise to your name, O Most High. When my enemies turn back, they shall fall and perish at your presence. For you have maintained my right and my cause. You sat on the throne judging in righteousness. You have rebuked the nations. You have destroyed the wicked. You have blotted out their name forever and ever. O enemy, destructions are finished forever, and you have destroyed cities, even their memories perished. But the Lord shall endure forever. He has prepared his throne for judgment. He shall judge the world in righteousness, and he shall administer judgment for the peoples in uprightness. The Lord also will be a refuge for the oppressed, a refuge in times of trouble. And those who know your name will put their trust in you, for you, Lord, have not forsaken those who seek you. Sing praises to the Lord who dwells in Zion. Declare his deeds among the people. When he avenges blood, he remembers them. He does not forget the cry of the humble. Have mercy on me, O Lord. Consider my trouble from those who hate me, you who lift me up from the gates of death, that I may tell of all your praise in the great gates of the daughter of Zion. I will rejoice in your salvation. The nations have sunk down in the pit which they made. In the net which they hid, their own foot is caught. The Lord is known by judgment he executes. The wicked is snared in the work of his own hands. The wicked shall be turned into hell, and all the nations that forget God. For the needy shall not always be forgotten. The expectations of the poor shall not perish forever. Arise, O Lord, do not let men prevail. Let the nations be judged in your sight. Put them in fear, O Lord, that the nations may know themselves to be but men. Join me in prayer. Lord, our Father, God in heaven, we thank you for the life that we have right now. We thank you for the strength and this privilege and opportunity to gather together to be able to lift your name on high, O God. We are nothing compared to you. We're very small compared to your holiness, to your greatness, and your majesty. But Lord, we thank you for your grace and mercy that even though we don't deserve anything, O God, and you don't ask anything, you give everything that we have. We thank you for the life of Jesus who died on the cross for our sins and who's the only way through our salvation, O God. And right now, everything that we'll be doing in here, in front, and even if those people are at home, we only aim to give glory and honor to your name alone. All this we pray in the mighty name of Jesus, our Redeemer. Amen.
Once again, good morning, everyone. Good morning, church. Happy Sunday. Happy Sunday, everyone, and to those watching online. This life offers us lots of roads, shall I say, pathways or ways. I call it, the desires of man. The most common are our careers, the way to success, to relationships. I'm not saying all these things are bad, but let me remind you, brethren, that in John 14:6 it says, Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father except through him. He is not a way, but the way. So I pray as we sing this song, I pray that whatever I mentioned beforehand, it will not overshadow our pursuit for Jesus, that he is only our priorities. So let us sing this song. Through every battle, through every heartbreak, through every circumstance, I believe that you are my fortress, that you are my portion, that you are my hiding place.
I believe you are the way, the truth, the light. I believe you are the way, the truth, the light. I believe in through every blessing and through every promise and through every bread I take, I believe that you are provider and you are protector and you are the one I love. I believe you are the way, the truth, set on you, and you meet me here today with mercies that are new. Oh, all my fears and doubts, they can all come to, because they can't stay long when I believe you are the way, the truth.
We serve is the God yesterday. He's the same God yesterday, today, tomorrow, and forever. He's never changing, never failing. As the words of the song says, who you were is who you are, and who you are, you always will be. Take me into your shelter.
There's no fire that can burn us. There's no wave too vast that you can't divide. 'Cause what you say will always come to pass. Lord, we kneel in awe of your great might. Almighty, your hope. Unchangeable God, you're perfect, you're faithful, all creation surrender because you say.
now it dwelled in us, so we could grasp how wide, how long, you say will always come to pass. Lord, we kneel and know your great love. Almighty, you're holy, eternal, unchangeable God, you're perfect. You're faithful. All creation surrender because you say so. Because you say so. Flowers will be for
of the stars, Lord God, every strand of our hair, Lord God, Lord, the flowers bloom and face you, Lord God, in their grand worship towards you, Lord God. Lord, you deserve every praises, Lord God. You deserve everything, Lord God. We praise and we glorify your name, Lord. In Jesus' mighty name, amen.
Amen. Good morning once again, children of the Most High. It is We thank the Lord for the beautiful weather, and it is a very pleasing sight to see everyone, how good it is when brethren dwells together in unity, in praising and worshiping the Lord in spirit and in truth. And truly, He is almighty, He is faithful, He is good, and He is unchanging. And this morning, let us all sing to the Lord, He reigns. Let us declare that the Lord reigns forever and ever. That will never change. You reign over all the earth, we sing it. You reign, justice and peace you bring it. You reign, holy one. You reign forevermore.
At this point, we would like to invite everyone to welcome one of our new attendees. We have a guest this morning. Let's acknowledge the presence of Miss Karen. She's right here. She arrived the UK, I think, January, if I'm not correct. And I think she saw the church in one of the social media. So it's very good opportunity for us, definitely, not only to share, you know, the church, our church, but of course the Word of God through this technology that we have right now. And now, at this point, we have someone who would like to share her testimony. His testimony about the blessing that she received from God. She's one of the younger ones, and it's a video presentation. So I would like to invite everyone to please watch this.
You loving me every day, and Lord, please love me every year and everywhere. And Lord, may you hear my prayers and testimonies.
Just would like to present to you our new series for today until sometimes in the mid of April. So it's called Marching Orders. So the Lord has called followers something to do. You familiar with the background song? The old hymn called Onward Christian Soldiers. As Christians and followers of Jesus, we are soldiers, and our commander, our general who is in heaven, has given us his marching orders. And because of that, we live by faith, and the faith that we live on is always under attack. Christian belief and Christian faith is under attack. Your convictions is under attack, especially even right now in the modern world where we live. And as ever before, even during the days and in the places where the gospel has been first preached, people who follow Christ are always under attack. So it has been rightly said that we are moving rapidly. Actually, we are truly moving rapidly towards the criminalization of Christianity. There will come a time that to be a Christian is a crime. And we are fast approaching those days, especially in the country where we live in. Because what has been celebrated before, the faith in God that people, especially in this country, has been celebrated before, is now being condemned. And what has been condemned before is now being celebrated. And those people who refuse to celebrate what has been condemned before are also being condemned. So, the earliest Christians that we can find in the Bible are people who faced a world that is idolatrous, that is pagan, that is godless, immoral, and I would say cruel towards those who follow Christ. That's why in Matthew chapter 10, the Lord gathers his 12 disciples and teach them and train them, and he has given them his marching orders. And the first passage that we can find is in Matthew chapter 10, verses 1 to 15. And what he has said to them, Jesus, what he has said to them is still saying to us, not only to them. So the messages that we're going to listen up to is being told to them. And in effect, it's still being said to us today. So starting today until the 16th of May, our series of messages will going to cover this chapter. We'll focus on this chapter. And today will be the start of those series, verses 1 to 15. And I believe the title of the topic that Pastor is going to share to us is Never Ashamed. Never Ashamed of the Gospel. And you've got Pastor Ronan today as our speaker. Thank you, Pastor, for coming.
Hello. Thank you, Pastor Joseph. Good morning, UCC. It's been a while that I've been here, so it's good to see you one and all. And yes, there are new faces. There are old but beautiful faces around. And I'm so glad to be here because of the theme of our sermon series is called Marching Orders. And when you think about marching orders, and we think about orders, we think about something like military-like or an army. Isn't that true? Amen? You remember when you were still in CAT, you were still in CAT or ROTC. I don't know if some of you have what we call this, have experienced that. Back in those days, it was hard, especially if you want to be an officer. Amen? Okay, so today I'm going to preach about one of the topic of marching orders is called Never Ashamed. Never Ashamed. Let me ask you this question. Have you ever been ashamed of anything? Okay? Sometimes it's not our fault that we are ashamed, maybe because we are ashamed of somebody else's fault. Yeah, we do experience that sometimes, don't we? Amen? Anyway, let us proceed to the passage in the Bible. And by the way, I would like to encourage also those who watch us in YouTube to give this every Sunday a series. You have to listen to this because these are very good sermons. The series is just so good, Marching Orders. When you think about marching orders, we think about the kingdom of heaven and how these orders are delegated. You see, I believe that the kingdom of heaven is a kingdom. And he has a king, and he has a dominion. And we function according to the direct order of our commander-in-chief, of course, is Jesus Christ himself, our king. Isn't that true? Say amen. Okay, shall we all stand for the reading of the passage and giving honor and reverence to the passage that we will read today from the scriptures. We're looking at Matthew chapter 10, verses 1 to 15. Matthew chapter 10, verses 1 to 15. we read, "And when he had called his 12 disciples to him, he gave them power over unclean spirits to cast them out and to heal all kinds of sickness and all kinds of disease. Now the names of the 12 apostles are this: first, Simon, who was called Peter, and Andrew, his brother, James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother, Philip and Bartholomew, Thomas and Matthew, the tax collector, James, the son of Alphaeus, and Lebeus, whose surname was Thaddeus, Simon the Canaanite, and Judas Iscariot, who also betrayed him." These 12 Jesus sent out and commanded them, saying, "Do not go into the way of the Gentiles, and do not enter a city of the Samaritans, but go rather to the lost sheep in the house of Israel. And as you go, preach, saying, 'The kingdom of heaven is at hand.' Heal the sick, cleanse the lepers, raise the dead, cast out demons. Freely you have received, freely give. Provide neither gold nor silver, nor copper in your money belts, nor bag for your journey, nor two tunics, nor sandals, nor staffs, for a worker is worthy of his food. Now whatever city or town you enter, inquire who in it is worthy, and stay there till you go out. And when you go out into the household, greet it. If the household is worthy, let your peace come upon it. But if it's not worthy, let your peace return to you. And whoever will not receive you nor hear your words, when you depart from the house or city, shake off the dust from your feet. Assuredly, I say to you, it will be more tolerable for the land of Sodom and Gomorrah in the day of judgment than for that city." May the Lord be blessed upon the reading of his word. Let us bow down our heads and pray. Father God in heaven, Lord, we thank you for this opportunity to hear from you. We come to you right now in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Father, as we hear your word, Lord, let our eyes be open, our ears be open. Lord, give us always the heart to understand, to perceive what you are trying to say to us as you dealt with us with your loving kindness and tender mercies. Once again, Lord, I submit myself in utter and complete dependence upon you, O God. Lord, I plead, Lord, that you will speak to your people today. Deal us in our hearts, O God, as we consider your words, Lord, and let your words grow in our hearts, Lord, to bear fruit in due season. Once again, Lord, we commit ourselves to you and give you all the praise, the glory, and honor. In Jesus' name we pray, and everybody says, amen. You all may be seated. Marching orders, okay? As I was saying, it's like a military-like. When you go into a military training, you have an officer above you, and the officer above you has an officer above. Okay, in the kingdom of God, I believe it's a kingdom wherein there is a hierarchy. There are ranks. Okay, there is a king and there is the subjects. Amen. And of course, our king is Lord Jesus Christ. We already established that, but we are his subjects. Amen. Okay, we are actually directly under his command. Now, who among you knows that the Lord Jesus Christ gives commands? Yeah. He gives commands either directly or indirectly through his delegated authority. And in the passage of Matthew chapter 10, which the title of the sermon is Never Ashamed, I will share to you about three things that we should not be ashamed of. And are you ready, my brothers and sisters? Say amen. And we have read the first part of the verse, when he had called his 12 disciples. You see, this is one thing that the present church should emphasize: disciples. We can do a lot of evangelism, but if we do not disciple those we have evangelized, those who have been born again, it's nothing. As a famous preacher said, evangelism without discipleship is zero. You have to understand that discipleship and evangelism are actually two sides of the coin. One can go without the other. Say amen. And it's established perfectly in what Jesus said before he went up to heaven. In Matthew chapter 8, he said, disciple all nations. In Mark chapter 16, he said, preach the gospel to all creatures. So preaching is evangelism, and discipleship is to disciple, of course. The only question in our present church is, do we have discipleship programs that would literally enable each and every believer to become like Christ? That each and every believer will come and walk in holiness. You see, a lot of people are afraid of holiness. They think it's about rules and regulations. But no. One of the famous preacher I admire is long gone. His name is J.C. Ryle. I don't know if you have read about the book of J.C. Ryle, Holiness. Very powerful book. Okay? I would recommend it. And the way he defines discipleship is nothing like what we define today about discipleship. We think about, holiness. When he defines holiness, as part of discipleship, of course, okay, he defines it as a more practical application. He said about four things or seven things about it, but there's just two points that impacted my life when I have read the book Holiness by J.C. Ryle. Number one is he defines practical holiness not about rules and regulation, but being one in mind with God. Being one in mind with God. That whatever God hates, if you are walking in holiness, you also hate what God hates. Whatever God loves, when you are walking in holiness, you will be walking and loving what God loves. So it's not about really rules and regulations. It's more about relationship. Amen? We all have our fathers, and perfectly we know what our father wants. Okay? There are things that our fathers doesn't want, and we don't really want to go against it. Otherwise, we'll be punished. Isn't that true? Well, the same with God. God is our father. We will be chastised if we go against him. According to Hebrews chapter 12. The second part of that discipleship that he did concerning holiness is that holiness is about following Christ. Christ being our example, okay? We follow him. That is being holy. If you do not follow Christ, you are not walking in holiness. Is that established? Amen? So very interesting, when Matthew wrote the first verse, when he had called his 12 disciples to him. 12 disciples to him. All right? So Jesus did not just call everyone to be believers. He calls everyone to be disciples. You see, there's a difference between believers and disciples. Every now and then, some Christians like to be believers, but they don't want to be disciples. And that's a very sad truth, isn't it? In order to walk with God, we have to be disciples. We have to follow Christ. And for quite a long time, the 12 disciples have followed Christ. And Christ have seen the crowd, and he had compassion, according to the previous chapter. All right? In verse 36 in Matthew chapter 9, but when he saw the multitudes, he was moved with compassion for them, because they were weary and scattered like sheep, having no shepherd. In other words, these guys are lost. We need to do something about it. Oh, disciples, come over here. I will give you power over every disease. I will give you power over unclean spirits to cast them out. Now, isn't that interesting? Matthew, in verse 2, says the names of the 12 apostles. So from being disciples, Matthew called them apostles. apostles, apostolos in Greek means sent forth. For you to be sent forth, you have a mission. For you to be sent forth, you come in one place and go to another. Isn't that true? Jesus is an apostle. Not an apostle, the apostle actually. In Hebrews chapter 3, he's the apostle. Why he's an apostle? Because he is also sent forth. Sent forth from where? From heaven to earth. It's that simple. And because Jesus was sent from heaven to earth, he has a mission. Actually, the angels revealed in a dream to Joseph, isn't it? You shall call him Jesus, and because he will save the people from their sins. And it started when Jesus became 30 years old. He came around in the nation of Israel saying, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." He was 30 years old. 30 years old down, there was no record of him what doing, except when he was 12, when he was wandering around the temple and talking to the Pharisees. And his parents got worried. So what's the point of this passages? Well, in order for you to become apostles, in order for you to come to the ministry that God has given you, you have first to be disciples. And this is why I encourage young people, do not be in a hurry to jump into the ministry. Is that clear? You have to establish first your relationship with God. Are you really following God? Are you really walking in holiness? Because in the future, it will affect whatever ministry you are in. There's just a lot of people in the body of Christ. They are not well discipled. They jump into the ministry and they end up with a lot of trouble. Why? Because they're not living holy lives, but they want to do ministry. And still others would envy a lot of people in the ministry. They think, "Wow, someday I'm going to be in a ministry. I want to be in a pulpit. I want to be in a platform." What are you doing now? "Well, I'm just serving tea and coffee." Aren't you in the ministry? Aren't you in the ministry? Okay. Remember, my brothers and sisters, that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. Amen? So people, do not be envious of somebody who is in a pulpit or who is in a platform. Just do your job wherever God calls you. All right? Because let me tell you, me and Pastor Joseph, when God appears in glory, he will call a lot of his servants. We're not the first pastor. There's just a lot of people out there more faithful than us. Okay? Whose eyes of the Lord are on them because they serve faithfully. All right? Do not jump right away into disciples. So Jesus saw these disciples. Oh, okay. I think you are now ready. All right? Apostles, sent forth. I'll give you power over unclean spirits, over all sickness and diseases. So the 12 went out. Now, I don't have to go through the names of the 12 apostles, okay? You and I both know. We can always read that. Of course, the first four is the inner circle of Jesus, all right? And always, Judas is the last one, all right? We all know why Judas is always the last one. Why? Because he was the betrayer of Jesus. So number one point in this marching order is never be ashamed to be a missionary. Amen? Pastor, am I a missionary? Of course you are. If you are a believer, you are actually called to share the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. You are actually called to disciple all nations. Amen? Now some of us have been called to a full-time ministry. Some of us are being called to the part-time ministry. And still some other of us are called into circumstantial ministry. Okay? Wherever you are, maybe you are at work and you seem to see yourself as, I'm not a missionary. When somebody appears in your life and said, "You know what? I think I need God." Then it's time for you to share the gospel. Amen? It's time for you to share the gospel. Never be ashamed to be a missionary. All right? You have a mission, my brothers and sisters. Okay? It may not be you can share every time, okay? And certainly if you pray enough, God will lead you to persons, which leads us to the next point. These 12 Jesus sent out in verse 5 commanded them saying, "Do not go into the way of the Gentiles, no, and do not enter to the city of Samaritans." Okay? Now, I don't think personally that Jesus has something against those people. All right? He's Samaritan. They are enemies of the Jews. And yet, we find in John chapter 4 that Jesus was talking to a Samaritan woman. Okay? In Matthew chapter 15 and even in Matthew chapter 8, we find Jesus, okay, marveled at the faith of these two, the Roman soldiers and the woman who was a Syrophoenician woman. Okay? Both of them, he called them, "Great is your faith." And he marveled. He even said, okay, "There's no such faith as this like in Israel." So I would say that Jesus has nothing to do with has nothing against with those people. And isn't it blessed that he has nothing against us, except our sins maybe. But because of his mercy, he reached out to us. And a lot of us got saved because of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. The gospel that we have heard has convicted us. Have changed us. Amen? And why is Jesus commanding them not to go in the way of the Gentiles, nor in the city of Samaritans? There is a priority, my friends. Okay? There is a priority. First of all, the Jews, they are the covenant people of God. Amen? Long, long ago in their forefathers. Their forefathers have actually, maybe the only generation who has actually seen the hand of God against the clutches of Egypt. The 10 plagues, the dividing of the sea. They have actually seen that, okay? I've never seen pastor doing dividing the canal, let alone the sea. So these covenant people are God's priority. All right? They are the ones they are the only nation that anticipates the coming of the Messiah. They know who is the Son of Man. They know who is the Son of David. Because those are the titles of Messiah. All right? They know what Christ means, the Anointed One. So Jesus commanded the disciples to go into the nation of Israel, especially to the lost sheep of Israel. All right? Why they are lost? Because they have it not returned to the Lord. The last prophet, Malachi, after God spoken to prophet Malachi for 430 years, there was no word of the Lord until John the Baptist came. And we find it in the book of Luke that the word of the Lord came to John the Baptist in the desert. So people going there, they thought he was the, what we call this, the Messiah. They thought he was the Christ. They thought he was the prophet with the capital P. Are you the prophet? No. What did he say? "I am the voice of the one crying in the wilderness, preparing the way of the Lord." And so, during that time, they know that the coming of the Messiah is here. So they saw Jesus doing miracles. All right? Some of them believed. Some of them didn't. Okay? Some of them even doubted. Even John the Baptist himself doubted in Matthew chapter 14. When he was in prison, He said to his disciples, can you go to Jesus and ask him if he's the one, or shall we wait for another? And Jesus said, oh, well, tell John, okay, the lame has walked, okay, the dead are raised to life, the poor has the gospel. Now, these are the types of things, or the what they call the signs. So we read in verse 7, as you go, preach, saying the kingdom of heaven is at hand, heal the sick, cleanse the leper, raise the dead, cast out demons. And now, why do they should do that? Okay? Because in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, it says that the Jews are seeking for a sign. When the Messiah came, they knew there has to be a sign that he is already here, the Messiah. So they're looking for the sign. So some of the signs are this. There is the healing of the sick. There's the raising of the dead. There's casting out demons. These are the signs. Now, signs are miracles. They are actually supernatural. They cannot be done naturally. They have to be done supernaturally with the power of God. Amen? And when these people saw this, oh, they marveled. Okay? There are a lot of things that Jesus did. And according to John, if you put it in a book, you can't even hold the book. Well, there's many of them. But what we can read in the Gospels are those kind of signs. That there's the raising of the dead, there's casting out demons, there's healing of the sick of all kind. All right? And signs, as I said, there are miracles, but it points to the Messiah. It points to the Messiah. It points to the Savior. That is the signs. The miracles did not just exist for the sake of miracles. You see, a lot of people want miracles, okay? Some even who do not need miracles want to see miracles for the sake of entertainment. Amen? Nowadays, they put up with these so-called healing crusades and make statements like, well, for a gospel to be authenticated, there has to be signs and wonders. Now, I'm sorry, but the gospel can stand itself without signs and wonders. Amen? What this Romans 1:16 says, okay, for I am not ashamed of the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, because it is the power of God unto salvation. Amen? The gospel itself is the power of God. It way goes beyond what's happening in the supernatural. What you see is healing. What you see is casting out demons. That's nothing compared to the one who is touched with the gospel. Because the one who are saved by the gospel will last for eternity. Amen? People who has actually witnessed some testimonies of miracles and things like that, especially in the Bible, they have seen it with the very eyes of Jesus. Think about feeding the 5,000. Have you read the one, the feeding of 5,000 in the Bible? Okay, with 2 fish and 3 bread. Yeah? That was a miracle. Okay, imagine. For just a small thing, it multiplies to 5,000. And some theologians would say it's even more, 16,000, because the 5,000 are just men, not counting the women and the children. They've seen, a lot of them seen 15,000. When Jesus was raised from the dead, there are only 500 of them. Okay? And Jesus instructed the 500 to go to Jerusalem, for you will receive the promise of the Father. And guess what? For 10 days, they waited and they said, no, I think we have to preach the gospel. So they go out. Some of them, we're already hungry, let's go out. We have to save our family. And guess what? Only 120 received the promise of the Father, the Holy Spirit. Where are the other 15,000? Where are the other 500? These people have seen the miracles, which gives me conclusion that miracles really does not save you. But why is there a miracle here? Because it authenticates the validity of the Savior. Amen? Now, Pastor, are you saying there's no healing anymore? There's no casting out of demons? There is. Okay? But it's no more an apostolic part of the ministry. It is already according to the sovereign will of God. Amen? Well, unlike during the days of the apostles, they were given powers. At their own will, they can command this and they can command that. Amen? You look at the book of Acts, they did that. All right? But 1 Corinthians chapter 12 is very clear about it, that the gifts of the Holy Spirit are actually controlled by the Holy Spirit himself. If we have that gift, we better be actually led by the Holy Spirit to do that. Otherwise, we will be fraud. Amen? And there's just a lot of fraud around in this world. The kingdom of heaven is at hand. Why? Because the king is already there in Israel. All they need to do is see that Jesus is their Messiah, but they failed. And actually disappoints Jesus. When Jesus said, Jerusalem, how I gathered you like a hen gathered her chicks. All right? But you're not willing, Jerusalem. So that's why the gospel reached out to the Gentiles. Through the apostle Paul and even some apostles like Thomas, he reached to India, even Andrew, okay, in northern Africa. They go as far as that. And aren't we thankful that the gospel was not only for the Jews, but also for the Gentiles? And that is why Paul said, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation, first for the Jews, and then he added also for the Gentiles. All right. In order for you to justify, you just have faith in our Lord Jesus Christ. Freely you have received, freely you give. All these things, the power that was given to the apostles, freely you give, freely you receive. Now imagine if they have a thinking like a modern preachers nowadays. Oh, I have the power to heal the sick. Let us have healing crusade. And those who go to the healing crusade, there is an entrance fee. And after that, we will put out an offering, okay, of minimum of $1,000. I think Jesus is going to be disgusted about it. Okay? Freely you give, freely you receive. They don't have that. I'm just thankful that those apostles doesn't have a mindset like most preachers today. Okay? I like what Leonard Ravenhill says. If Jesus were to preach like preachers today, he would have never been crucified. But we know that's not our Jesus. Jesus will always speak the truth. He is the faithful and true witness. He won't lie to you. Okay? So if you're here and you do not know Jesus, he will speak to you about truth. He will not flatter you. Okay? Like most preachers do nowadays, they flatter you. They send you a gospel different from the real gospel. Oh, you have everything now, but you only need Jesus in your life. That's a cherry top gospel. You make Jesus an accessory. Let me tell you, my friends, without Jesus, you are nothing. Without Jesus, we are nothing. Amen? Provide neither gold or silver nor copper in your money belts. Jesus doesn't want his servants being worried about what he has to provide. Now, I believe when God guides, God provides. Isn't that true? Wherever you go, if God guides you, he will provide. If you look at the ministry of Elijah, who among you here have read the book of the story of Elijah? Okay? There were no caterers during that time of famine. He sent birds to feed Elijah. Must be a wonderful sight. The birds are coming. Oh, They got food. What is it? Is it a steak? You know? And after that, he even had the brook with the water, and after it dried up, okay, your time is up here, Mr. Elijah. Go to the widow. I have commanded her to provide for you. And he went to the widow. The widow even complained, "Oh, we only have this oil. We don't have this flour. We're just going to eat and die." All right? It's funny how it seems sometimes we're so worried about a lot of things. When Jesus said we are not to worry, okay, what food we eat, what clothes we wear. But sometimes we do, don't we? Okay, human as we are, but that's not an excuse. Since now you are a believer, you should know how to exercise that God is a provider. You have to have faith in God that He is the provider. Amen? All right? There are just a lot of testimonies who are what we call this, who are been given the gift of liberty, of giving. Okay? You just imagine the testimonies. God has them 0.0 blank in their account. All right? But they trusted God. All right? The testimony of George Mueller. I don't know if you read about George Mueller. He was born during, I think, the Reformers' time. All right? He actually has a ministry, and his ministry is children, orphanage. They have nothing to eat one morning. All right? But God said, oh, God will provide. Okay, just pray. And suddenly there was a knock at the door. It was a baker. And the baker said, look, my carriage has been broken. And I don't like this bread to be what we call spoiled. So can you just help me get the bread and we will feed your children? What a wonderful way, you know, that God has on his children. He provides. So my brothers and sisters, every time you worry about a lot of things, please do remember that God provides. Amen. Nor bag for your journey, nor tunics. We have already covered that. Nor sandal for staff, for a worker is worthy of his food. You see, if you're the worker in the kingdom of God, you don't have to worry about anything that he provides. That is, if God really guides you to do it. But there's just a lot of people who got frustrated with God. I seem to remember many, many years ago, I have a friend. She has a ministry. Okay, she and her husband have ministry. And they were excited. Why? Because they are going to Thailand. They are going to a missionary in Thailand. All right? And when they went to Thailand, okay, the first few months, they're okay. But suddenly, they run out of things that they need. So they prayed, and they prayed. And there was nothing. Now they're so worried. And after they got worried, there's still nothing. They prayed, there's still nothing. They got mad. So they called up the ministry in the Philippines. How is it that there's no, what we call this, walang padala. There's no, what we call this. And later they know that they were not called to be missionaries. Okay? Now this is why the discipleship is very, very important. Because when you are walking with God in holiness, when you're walking with God in a relationship, you will know whether you're called or not. Amen? Now, whatever, okay, my second point is, all right, do not be ashamed. Never be ashamed, point number two, of your mission field. God, when He puts you in a mission field, He sends you to the right place, in the right time, in the right person. In this case, He sent the apostles to the lost sheep of Israel. Why lost sheep? These are the covenant people. Now, I want you to, what we call this, I want you to reflect on something. Inasmuch that there are lost sheep in Israel, I guarantee you there are people who are lost in the church as well. There are who are lost in the sheep in a way. They're not lost in their salvation, but they are lost. What are they going to do? You know? what are we going to do in the church? When they are not discipled well, they will be very lost. Okay? Now, whatever city or town you enter, inquire who in it is worthy and stay there till you go out. You have to understand that the nation of Israel, they are most hospitable nation. They know when a certain man of God, they know when a certain prophet, they know, okay, the bringing of good news, they will host. They will host people. And as such, one of the things that a lot of leaders are to be required about this is that the leaders, especially bishop in 1 Timothy chapter 3, that we are to be hospitable. Okay? Not only the bishop, but also the people should be hospitable. And when you go out into the household, greet it. All right? So there is actually an instruction from the Lord Jesus on how to enter into the house, how to meet the host of the house. Greet it. And usually, if they are Jews, when you greet somebody, you say shalom. Amen? Shalom. Peace. All right? It is actually what we call this, a very prophetic word. It is to feel and fulfilled and be filled. If you are filled with the Holy Spirit, you are fulfilled when Jesus comes back. Greet it. If the household is worthy, let your peace come upon it. Shalom. But if it's not worthy, let your peace return to you. In other words, don't waste time. If you're not welcome, don't waste time. You see, when it comes to the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, I deem it as precious. It is not to be trifled with. And Jesus said, do not give your pearls into the swine, lest they trample it. All right? For one thing, swines do not wear pearls. So what are they going to do? They're just going to trample it. Why? Because it's nothing to them. It's worthless to them. Okay? And whoever will not receive you nor hear your words when you depart from that house, shake off the dust from your feet. This is actually an act of disdain for those who rejected the gospel. All right? Shake off your dust. Same with Paul and Silas after they were being rejected. Okay? In the book of Acts, they shake off the dust. Meaning, we don't want to do it with you anymore. Since you have rejected the gospel, you rejected the words, okay, judgment is the only option for you. And that is why, okay, assuredly in verse 15, I say to you, it will be more tolerable for the land of Sodom and Gomorrah in the day of judgment than that for the city. You think about Sodom and Gomorrah. Have you read about Sodom and Gomorrah? Yes. And that's very awful. People are being incinerated by the fire of God. Okay? And Lot and his family are not to look back because of the judgment of God. All right? You see, every time when God judges, all right, believers are withheld from seeing that judgment. We see this in the judgment and the time of Noah. That God has actually to shut up all the door. He shut us all the windows. And people outside are screaming, save us. All right? We're drowning. Because it's very awful if you see someone struggling and going for death. Isn't it true? Now, we all see this in the hospital, okay? An ICU patient struggling for breath. Dying of COVID, wanting to say something but couldn't because he's struggling for breath. It's very awful, an awful sight. But you see, this is the thing that we should consider. Our marching orders not only include never to be ashamed of being a missionary, not being ashamed to be in a mission field, we should not also be ashamed of the mission. That's the last bit of the point. We should not be ashamed of the mission. You and I have a mission. You just open your eyes wide and you will see a lot of people from all walks of life who do not know Jesus at all. All right? And I don't know about you, but whenever I see people like that, it just waves from my mind. Unless there is a gospel shared to them, they are really condemned. They are going to hell. You know every family, you know every friends you have, okay? Maybe they laugh at you because you are a Christian now. They mock at you because you are a Christian now. You share to them the gospel and they still laugh. All right? In all honesty, they shouldn't be laughing. Okay? If they only knew what will happen to them. In Sodom and Gomorrah, those people, you see, they were incinerated physically. What more in the day of judgment? All right? In the day of judgment, you are not incinerated only physically. You are tormented. Okay? As Jesus said, the fire will never quench and the worms will never die. It will eat you up over and over and over again till eternity. All right? And you know what eternity means. It's a very long time. Very long time. It doesn't even have an ending. You say, when you get in prison in this world, some prisoners will say, oh, next year I'll be out. I will be out next month. In hell or lake of fire? Never. I'm telling you, my brothers and sisters, nobody even escaped from there. People can escape from Alcatraz. People can escape from Bilibid prison. People can escape from every prison in the world. But hell, no. You can't escape when you're being judged. All right? That is why it's important to consider the mission, my brothers and sisters. Let us consider that the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ has to reach to the people whom we love, who our family, or even our work co-workers out there. Ask God for opportunities for you to share to them the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. And just don't care about whether they laugh at you, they will sneer at you, or they will mock at you. As long as you have obeyed the Lord Jesus Christ when Jesus said, preach the nation, I preach the gospel to all nations and disciple all nations. Yes, do that. And it is the mandate of our Lord Jesus Christ. It's the marching order of our Lord Jesus Christ to advance the kingdom to the hearts of the people. Because let me tell you, my brothers and sisters, okay, there is a war going on out there. And our commander-in-chief is actually commanding us to go march forward. And remember the promise of our Lord Jesus Christ that the gates of Hades shall not prevail against us. Okay? If we are founded as children of God, as we are founded as Christians, and we are founded as a whole body of Christ as a church, and Jesus said, I will build my church and the gates of Hades shall not prevail. He didn't say the gates of heaven or the gates of the church. No, it's gates of Hades. In other words, it's offensive. It is an attack mode. But what's the problem sometimes when we see a lot of churches? They are not on attack mode. Sometimes we get comfortable in fellowships. And it's good we have fellowships, my brothers and sisters. But let us not forget the mission. Amen? In the book of Acts, they got comfortable with their fellowship. And that's why God has to allow the heat of persecution so that he spread everywhere. Why? Because there's a mission to spread the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. And Paul keeps rebuking, especially in the book of Thessalonians. Okay? When they get the comfortable in the fellowship, they were just busybodies going all around. And some others do not work. And that's why Paul has said to them, those who do not work, do not eat. Because we are supposed to be workers in the kingdom of God. We are supposed to be armies in the kingdom of God. Let's act like it. Amen? Let us not look as Christians or people who are just on a Sunday service, sitting on the pews, or attending Bible studies. No. You have to be more aggressive than that. Why? Because the souls of the people are at stake. Every time you see a lot of people, be it as sinful people, as a prostitute, or even a homosexual, or even those people whom you do not know, I always see them. I don't know about you, I always see them. Christ died for them. You owe it a lot to share to them the gospel. It is important, my brothers and sisters, to be part of the army of the Lord, whose marching orders. Never to be ashamed being a missionary. Never be ashamed where you are. God has you where you are. You see, when I became a Christian, I was backslidden for about 15 years. And when I go abroad, I'm so happy. Yes, I'm going to have pounds. You know, I'm going to earn a lot of money. But God has you where you should be. Amen? You have a mission. It is not just working here in England. A lot of people out there needs the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Never be ashamed to be in any of your mission field. God has you in Aden Brooks. God has you in the nursing care homes. All right? He has a mission for you there. God has you in the schools. God has you in the wherever you are. Okay? Because you have a mission. And lastly, never to be ashamed of the mission. The mission is to spread the gospel, which is precious, by the way, because Jesus Christ shed the blood, his precious blood, for you and me and for all the others in the world. Let us share the gospel. Let us all rise up. Let us bow down our heads and reflect. If you have heard this message today, I want you to examine yourself. To ask yourself, are you walking in holiness? Are you walking and serving God? Would you like to do your part now as part of His army with the marching orders, never be ashamed? I want you to reflect on that with Jesus Himself in a minute or two. Right now, Lord, deal with us, Lord. Let our conscience be sharpened, O God, to reflect within ourselves, Lord, to consider your orders. Father, give us courage, give us wisdom, lead us to the right people in the right place in the right time. Remind us always, Lord, what you have done on the cross, and Lord, let your message, Lord, be with us, Lord, being the bearer, Lord, of your word. And Father, we just ask, Lord, as you have led, you lead us in the situation to share the gospel, Lord. Give us boldness, Lord, to declare it, not be ashamed of it, but rather rejoice, Lord, that we have obeyed you in spite of everything, despite all the odds. Father, we thank you for the message today. We thank you. You pierced our hearts to reconsider what we should do as Christians in these last days. You have given us orders, Lord. Now, O God, give us a chance to execute those orders, Lord, according to your perfect will in the perfect time. Father, we just rejoice, Lord, for hearing this message. May this message go in our hearts, Lord, as we walk with you, as we serve you. To you alone, O God, be glory, honor, and praise. In Jesus' name we pray. And everybody says, amen. God bless you all, UCC.
Thank you, for Pastor Onan, for the message that we've heard this morning. And every one of us has been reminded not to be ashamed to be a missionary and not to be ashamed of the mission field. And, of course, not to be ashamed of the mission as well. But I think in relation to this, I would like to encourage everyone who's here and even those people who are at home not to hold back when it comes to giving, not only financially, but also with a service, with what we have, what we can offer to God. This mission, just like Pastor has been mentioning a lot of times throughout the message, this mission is not a mission of just one, two, or three, or of some, but it's a mission of every one of us. And for those of us in here, the cheerful givers, who would like to share whatever they have financially, we have the account number or the account details of the church, the United Christian Church, on the screen, 738-93774, sort code 201735, and you can also see this on our website. It's ucccambridge.org. And also, as of the moment, we're doing this because we cannot do the usual when we bring our money or our offering here in church. But for now, this is what we're going to do if you would like to share or for our tithes and offering as well. And also, I know every one of us are delighted that everyone is growing spiritually, but I think it's not just me who is noticing that a number of those who attend the church is growing as well. That's why we are praying, everyone's praying, that we will have, for us to have our own church. And for those who would like to help out financially with this project, the account numbers or the bank details are on screen as well. And just like I mentioned a while ago, you can also see this in our website. And right now, we're going to hear a special number, a song which will be offered by one of our sisters, Miss Bea De Vera. Let's listen to it.
us pray. Lord, we thank you for this beautiful day that you've given us, O God, and we thank you for all your protection and your blessings upon each and every one of us, O Lord. And we thank you for the word that Pastor Ronan has shared today, O Lord. And I pray, O Lord, that we use this in our daily lives, and may we never be ashamed, O Lord, for being a missionary, for carrying out your mission, O Lord. And I pray, O Lord, for these tithes and offerings. And may you bless those who have cheerfully given what is yours, O God, and may we use it for the expansion of your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Okay. Thank you, Maya. And at this point, we just would like to acknowledge, because a person, an individual, has become recently become a member of our church. And in UCC, we give people who want to be a member, we give them what we call the membership class. It's a module, it's a teaching class that is being done 3 to 4 sessions. So we teach them the fundamentals of the Christian life and how is it that God has called us and he has put us into this church. So recently, there is one who have committed himself to become a member of the church. Actually, he's been attending already, but it's just recently that he has done the membership class. Can we call on Richard, please? And Richard, actually, it was Mary Grace who first came to know the Lord. And at first, Richard has been hesitant about the Lord to come into faith. Kaya lang, from what I've heard, Malchris is just being patient, showing what it's like to be a Christian wife. Although Richard during then is still a bit, resistant to the gospel. And we all understand that because that's how we used to be before we came to know the Lord. But Malchris just kept on submitting. We're pleading to her, you just follow Richard, he's still your head. And show him how it's like to be a follower of Christ. And I believe Richard has seen that in Marie Chris. That's why eventually he himself has given the consideration to hear the gospel. But eventually he became born again. He has got Jesus now as his Lord and Savior. And not only that, he is now a member of the church. I think, Richard, you play music, hindi ba? Because I am the one who taught you, diba? Lagi may ganun. He's one of my prospects to do the pulpit ministry as well. Because mahina lang ang loob niya. He doesn't see that. But the Lord also already gave me the insight. I see that in him. Kailangan lang lumakas ang loob. You know what? Men are sometimes nahihiya sila sa pulpito, but once they overcome that, they don't want to stop talking anymore. You need to stop them. So that's how it is, Richard. But anyway, you praise the Lord for yourself, kapatid. I'm always saying, the Lord has put us, every one of us, in this place. We've got a mission, and we've got a marching orders, and everyone is included. Amen po ba? Let's pray for Richard. Can we extend our hands saying we bless him? And we bless Richard. And thank you for him, for his life. You have called him and you have saved him. Help him to grow with us, O Lord, in this church. Help him to develop his faith, that he will all the more know Jesus personally in his life, the wonders of his love, and the power of his grace. Help him to be the leader of his home. O Lord, give him the insight. O Lord, empower him and reveal yourself to him. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you.
Congratulations, Richard, and welcome to United Christian Church. And I'm one of those people who got blessed hearing his testimonies during the classes. It was a beautiful testimony. It was stunning as well, like literally, after hearing the
his testimonies were not able to speak immediately because it was really beautiful and just a blessing for everyone who heard it. And I'm encouraging every one of us as well, if you know, to share our lives to our brothers and sisters here in church as well, to share our testimonies, to inspire them further, for us to be able to consistently press on with our mission here on earth. And right now, we are going to go to our announcements. Of course, in relation to COVID-19, we still are following the guidelines. Currently, we're still on doing bookings. You know, it's a first-come, first-served basis still. So if you want to attend here physically in our building, just visit our website. It's ucccambridge.org. And you will see a sheet there. It's more of a health declaration, actually. Just fill that in, and that will be forwarded to one of our sisters, Rena, and then she will respond to you and confirm your attendance as well. So once your attendance is confirmed, I would like to encourage everyone, before entering this building, to do some hand hygiene, just to prevent spreading infection or whatever we have, not only COVID, you know, where we have our bacteria everywhere anyway. So just for us to stay healthy, we should do that. And we are also observing a one-way system here. So the entrance will be at the back and the exit will be in front. So it's the other way around this for now. And also, while we are here in the service, we encourage everyone to wear face mask or protection also. And also, of course, our activities don't stop here in every Sunday. We have activities as well during the week. And every Tuesday, we have the prayer meetings. It's a joint prayer meeting. It's still over Zoom. It starts at 9 o'clock every Tuesday. The link normally is posted on any of our social media accounts, the UCC social media Facebook account, the Life Group Facebook account, and some of the threads also. If you're a member of the thread, you can see the link in there. And aside from that, every Thursday, the Young Professional Ministry of United Christian Church also has got an activity every Thursday, which starts at 8 o'clock. And just like the prayer meeting, we still conduct it over Zoom. And normally what we do is we discuss further, like we talk about the topic that we've heard or the message that we've heard on Sunday, just to give more insights into it and to look further into it and also discuss the application of the message in our lives as well. So if you would like to join that, just like the prayer meetings, you can see the link through our social media, different social media accounts, and just join us. It doesn't matter. You know, everyone is welcome.
And in response to the message for today, let's sing this song. Jesus is alive. It's a good reminder for all of us, you know, never be ashamed to be a missionary. Never be ashamed of our mission field. Never be ashamed of our mission. And wherever God leads, He guides and He provides. And wherever God puts us, that's our mission field. Our lives are to point everyone to Jesus because people need the Lord. We are nothing without God. To point everyone to Jesus where there is no condemnation, no fear, no doubts. And Jesus, the way, the truth, and the life, because no one comes to the Father except through Him. Let's sing this song. Buried lives again.
Living King, and He's given us His orders, and we need to follow for the glory of His name. Father God, we thank You, Lord, for the celebration of Your people. We celebrate because You are great, because we've got a living God in You and in Christ Jesus. We thank You, Lord, it is precious that You have given us Your commands. We are confident in You, O Lord, because You yourself have commanded us, but in reality, You are working with us. You are empowering us, and You are going along the way with us. Thank You, Lord. It is a privilege to work with You and a servant of You and a soldier of You. Help us to be faithful, to seek the lost, because You have died for them and You care for them. Give us the delight and the love that comes from You so that we will love all the more, O Lord, especially those people who are far from You. Give us the grace in our hearts and the power in our heart, O Lord, to share the gospel, to speak up. Even though people nowadays are attacking our faith, they are intolerant of the gospel, and they are intolerant of the Bible and of the scripture. But help us all the more, O Lord, empower Your people. Help us to shine as light for You, and help us to be salt in this world, that people may find that there is something different in us. O Lord, that they may find the flavor that they are looking for, the sweet aroma of Christ. We thank You, Lord, for today, and we glory in Your name. Now, may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, equip you with everything good that you may do His will, working in us that which is pleasing in His sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. You can all be seated.